Hello and welcome to another magic show, which is going to be a bit of a Mickey Mouse show this week, I'm afraid. We've got the mouse here. Would you like to hold that? Now, don't worry. While you were watching the titles, we swapped it for a plastic one. You can keep that souvenir. Do you know, normally in these shows, I never get up to see the back people at all. I'm going up here tonight. What we're going to do, I'll explain what we're going to happen here. We're going to have a telekinetic experience. Have you ever had one?
What?
Not a lot to say, that, is there? Well, in that case, you won't have one now. I'll pick him on the end instead. And you, my lovely, and you, sir, because you're sitting at the front and you're very handy for now. Would you mind coming down and joining me at the table? We're going to have, as I said, a telekinetic experience. Bring your mouse, we don't care. Yes. And would you mind sitting around the table? But when you sit, lady in the centre, I think, there. And when you sit down, I want you to pull the chairs right into the table. Make yourself at home, make yourself cosy, all right? And when you do that, would you like to have a look underneath the table as well and make sure there's nothing wrong under there, there's no mechanism? You can tap the top. It's an old Victorian table. That's all you can call it, isn't it? And you're happy there's no mechanisms, no secret catches. It wouldn't matter if there was, because what we're going to do is this, you see, shake it out. I'll make somebody a lovely wife one day. If you do not know what a telekinetic happening is, let me explain. It starts out like a card trick and finishes up a bit spooky, you know. Aye. But we have a pack of cards, and they're all different. Now, what you're going to do is you're going to get some of these cards, and they really are all different, all right? And you're going to get some of the cards, okay? And what I want you to do is just, you can either look at the faces of the cards and select one that you particularly like, or you can just slide one out blind. We don't really mind, you know, you can do it either way. Well, ladies, take one blind. How are you going to know what it is later? You don't care, do you? Right. All right. One, two, we have three cards, all right? These are, of course, as I said, all different. They just form the rest of the pack. Now, what is going to happen now? I'm going to cut the cards, and we'll take yours, my lovely, first, which is the five of spades, all right? Mm-hmm. And I'm going to put the five of spades in there. Now, you can see it. The five of spades goes right into the pack, all right? And as it goes into the pack, we then take this next card, which is yours, the ace of clubs, and we put that into the pack as well. All right? Happy? Fine. And when we cut the cards again, and we'll put your card, which is the three of hearts, in there. Now then, would you believe that we are surrounded by the spirits? Watch me lips. Would you believe? It's going to be a long night, this. Now look, we just put the pack in the middle, and you rest your hands all the way around like this. You just... fingers and thumbs, I tell you what, just your thumbs touching, because otherwise you'll get too crowded. That's the idea. Now, what we need is the power of your mind. It's going to be very difficult to make anything happen. Now, to make it happen, you've got to have spooky lighting, okay? So we have a touch of the spooks. And then, as the lights dim, you concentrate on the pack, which is sitting in the middle of the table, which you have seen is all different. And as you concentrate, the pack will start to move, but concentrate, make your mind, make the pack move. You're not thinking. Move the pack with the brain. That's it, you're doing it, you're doing it. You're doing a really good job there. Now, what we do now is we'll see where it has cut, all right? It has cut the cards just there, all right? Let's take out that card and see what it is. It is, in fact, the three of hearts. Whose was that?
Mine.
That was yours?
Yes.
Ah, then it's you that's not working. Right. You. So I'll tell you what to do. Now, I don't know whether this will work or not. You've got the three of hearts. Get hold of that invisible thread. I like you. You're silly like me. You've got to pull it towards the edge of the table. You see, you just pull the invisible thread. No, you're not pulling hard. Now, get hold of it further along. There you are. Twice he's proved he's daft. Now, he's pulling it well. Look at that. He's pulling the card right out. That's enough, sir. You don't have to work hard on this show. You've done it. Was that your card? The ace of clubs. Now, I've got to tell you the honest truth. A lot of people at home, you know, think that when he gets all of that, there really is a thread there. Could you feel a thread? I mean, there really isn't anything, is it? But to prove that there isn't, we've got this. Now, this is a what is called a bell jar. And underneath there, they used to put all sorts of old, dead, dried-up objects. And what we won't do that. Instead of that, we shall cover the pack like so with it. Now, if you don't move your fingers, sir, you're going to get them rudely chopped off. And never again will you be able to say goodnight to the foreman in the same way. Now, you rest your fingers now on top of the bell jar. And this really is for the benefit of the people at home. You here know that there's nothing happening with secret threads and all that. Now, really go. Come on now. Now the pack is going to go. Go on. Away. Concentrate. Go. Away she goes. Now, isn't that good? Isn't that amazing? Tremendous. It's fantastic. I'm underwhelmed as well. And what you do is you concentrate some more and try to make the pack reject the last card, which was yours, I think. Right? Okay. One for her. Back she comes. Come on now. Come on. Force yourself. That's it. Oh, look. Oh, it's doing pirouettes. Bah. The power of your brain is... Oh, that's it. That's it. You must be the one that's always going around in circles. And it is... Just let's take that off there and let's have a look at the pack itself. And you will find that it is just a pack of cards, which is what we started off with, all right? And it doesn't matter, you could have had any of those, but it did reject that one, which was your card, I think, the five of spades, and it rejected yours, the three of hearts, and the ace of clubs. Circus, we bring you one of the finest acts of its kind in the world, again, because we're always doing that, but if you've ever tried to crack a whip, have you ever tried that, and make that big rack of a sound, it's very, very difficult indeed. It is really difficult. We've got a man who's a world master at it, and with the lasso also. So I'd like you to watch the skills of Boh Rosetti. Thank you. And welcome to another Bunko Board, where, if you remember, or even if you don't, I'll tell you, we give away money and then we try to win it back in one of the fairground or sideshow or street-type cons that are going. We call them bunkos, all right? An old word for being fiddled. Now, that's one, two, three, four, £25 for you. I've got £25 for me. What's your name?
Alan
Crofts.
Crofts,
yeah. I see. Now, this is a very simple idea in con, but it's beautifully done. Look, this is a tin lid. It's screwed down with four screws to the base, right. All right?
Yep.
Now, that means that that solid cone there, which is solid, when it's sitting on there, can't move in any direction.
Right.
You agree?
Yeah. Yes.
Hey, what a kind fellow you are, but it's true. Now, the next stage is to place this here, there, on that little hook. Hangs on the frame. That's a wooden ball. Now, all you have to do, Alan, is swing the ball just past the cone so that on the way back it knocks it down. Rather like the old bar game of skittles, you know? You
yeah.
ever played that?
Yeah.
Oh. We could be in trouble here tonight. Right, now, but the idea is, see if I can do it first. I should be able to do it because I'm an expert. Boing! You see, would you like to have a go yourself?
Yeah.
You, no, just stand around this side and then the people at home will be able to see just as well. What you've got to do is invest £5 and I'll cover it with five. Now, if you knock it over on the way back, you keep the money.
Right.
Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Right, away you go. Forward, go, backwards. Oh, you only wobbled it, you see? You should have given it a bigger throw, you know? Yes, have another five. Have another five on it, Alan. I'll cover it with five on that. No, Alan! You hit it on the way back, Alan. It's not easy being daft, is it? Now, look, go straight. Now, watch me lift. You go past the end. Right? No, no, not there. No, you don't need it there. It's like Conkers, Alan. All right? You ever played Conkers?
Yes, I have.
Great! Great, Alan. Now, just past there with the ball, Alan. And back you go. You've lost, Alan. Right, there we are. Now, Alan, I've got to tell you, you've been kidded on. Thanks for taking the jokes, but you stand over there next to your £15, right. And I'll tell you how you were swindled. What it's got to do with is the frame, which is wonky. You tip that way, watch. You can swing just past there, and on the way back, it knocks the skittle over. But, Alan, if I tip it this way, towards me, it doesn't matter where you swing it from, you're going to miss. So you were swindled out of £10. You don't get it back because we charge that much for the lesson. Right. But it seemed to us that in the world of magic, you should be able to cheat a little better than that. So we get rid of the wobbly frame. Thank you, Amanda. And let me demonstrate to you something rather different to that. That is this. This is a solid frame. And you can see the corners there, metal bound, nothing moves. Corner here, metal bound, nothing moves. Not only that, we had a joiner fit a, well, they're not joiners anymore, are they? We had a timber technician. Everybody's got new names now. This piece of timber goes up over the top, round, it's curved, so it stops it wobbling in any direction. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Righto. Now, this hangs in that, which doesn't move at all. You'll see there's a little arrow points straight down at it there, all right? And that doesn't slide either. Would you like to test that? In fact, hang that up yourself. Hang it up yourself, then you'll know you're not being kidded, all right? Good laddie. £5? Here we go. I'll cover it. No, Alan, you're at it again, Alan. You've got to knock it on the way past, on the way back, I mean. That's it. Go on. Oh, Alan, you've missed again. Now, Alan, another go, because you've got £5 left. Go on. Oh, Alan has missed again. Right, now. Oh, you've got another five. I was wrong. There must have been £10 left. I'll tell you what we'll do. I like you. Not a lot, but I like it. So what I will do is I will make it so that you cannot possibly lose. That is a cone. It therefore has a narrow top. Hasn't it, Alan?
Yes.
Yes, it has. So what we're going to give you to aim at is this, which is a skittle, which has a fat top. Hasn't it, Alan?
Yes.
You can't therefore miss, can you, Alan?
I hope not.
No. Don't gamble your money yet, son. Have a go. Knock it over, see if you can. Oh, he's a clever boy now. Alan, right. Take your fiver, put your £5 on there, Alan. Swing just past there and away we go. And I'll tell you what we'll do. It looked like it was going to knock it over. Tell you what we'll do, Alan. I feel in a generous mood. I'm going to put £10 on there and I shall give you this. A bigger ball. No, no, Alan. You see, what you got to do, Alan, is swing. What do you do for a living, Alan?
Telex.
Telex operator.
Supervisor.
Oh, a telex supervisor, yes. Well, you'd probably miss the keys if you tried it yourself. Anyway, this time, steady, boy. Just passed, and before we go any further, I'll put the lot on. I feel confident now I've seen you doing it. Right. Just miss it on the way out. That's it. And woo! You did it on the way back as well. You missed. And if you just stand over there, Alan, can I just say something to you, son? That no matter how hard you try to win in a bunko bull, the street con, you never will win. Never put money on it. Not now, not ever, not never. We've taken all the money back, but we'd like you to have a memento of the programme, and we've got here a set of these, and these are bar skittles, all right? And then you've practiced that until you can do it every time. You will still not be able to do this in the bunko bull. He's known throughout the circus world as the top circus ringmaster in the business. Today he is with us in a different guise, with his budgerigars from the Blackpool Tower Circus, Mr. Norman Barrett.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, fellas, it's time we did some work. I'll introduce them. They've all got names. This is Freddie Halfpenny and Morris. Come on, Morris. There's a good boy. Right, run, son. Keep running, baby. And a little bit quicker, and the applause will start in a minute. That's the idea, you've got. Good boy, right. One, two, up. Come on, thank you very much. Okay, come on, Harold. There's a good boy, Harold. Freddie Halfpenny. Come on, son. Right, jump, baby. Hurry up, keep you. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Keep going. Right, turn round, turn round. Wait, turn round, precious. Turn round. Excuse me, he speaks French. Bonnet, s'il vous plaît. Merci. Come on, Peppy. Off you go, Peppy. Jump, sir. There's a good boy. Get it going, Peppy. A little bit quick. Up. Come on, Peppy, again. Very good. One, two, up. Morris, jump, son. Not yet, not yet. Morris, there's a good boy. Turn round, Morris, one more time. That's a good boy, right. The same thing, right along. No, 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 no. Come on, Freddie Halfpenny. Here he is. Come on, son. Waltz round, you know, that's a good boy. Right, son. Come on, jump, my baby. There's a good boy. One more time. Up. Five, yes. Come on, Peppy. Peppy, quickly. Right up. Jump. Peppy, jump. Good boy. One more time. Fine, good boy. Yeah. Harold. Come on, Harold. There's a good boy, Harold. So this is the bit we're going to do for Prince Charles. Yes, come sit. Turn around, baby. That's the idea. Come on. Engelbert. There's a good boy, Engelbert. Sit still. Rupert, Rupert, that's a good one. Now watch very carefully. Here we go. Right, up, one, up two, Rupert, quickly, up. That's fine. Thank you, that's a good boy. Sit down. Go and sit down. Keep the place tidy. Papa's coming back. We'll try the bicycle trick next. Harold, come on, Harold. Harold, he's nodded off as Harold. Harold. There's a good boy, Harold. That's it. You're on the wrong perch. Thank you. Malcolm. There's a good boy. That's Malcolm. Good boy. Sit still. Hold tight. What I want you to do, Larry, is to run along the table, climb up the pole, and get on top of the bike. Right, watch him as he runs along the table, doesn't climb up the pole, and doesn't get on the bike. Right. This time, son. Are you ready? Right. Along the table, up the pole, up. You think he won't do it, don't you? You're right, he won't. You'll be on a plate with some chips if you're not careful. There he goes, right, along the table, up the pole and on the bike. Now look, you stupid bird, look. All you've got to do is run along the table, climb up the pole and get on top of the bike. Now it's a difficult trick for an elephant, but for a budgerigar, you're not supposed to be doing that. Why, that? Don't get off, don't get off. We've only done half the trick. There's a good boy. We might get half the money. There's a good boy. Sit still. Hold tight, hold tight.
Very good indeed. Stay there, Morris. Let's go, let's go. Right up. Come on, Cyril. Turn round, son. Cyril, there's a little boy. Freddie Halfpenny. Peppy, come on, Pep. There's a good boy, Peppy. And Morris, there's a good boy, Morris. Sit still. Thank you, sir. Could we have the can-can? Let's go. Okay, quickly, go on. Quicker, quicker, go on, quicker.
Did you know that science has advanced to the stage where they can actually tell you what sex the baby is going to be before you've had it? Did you know that? Not many people do. And what we thought might be a nice idea tonight, and this will come as a surprise to the jury, we thought it would be a nice idea if we tried to name a baby before the parents did. So, here is a baby. Thank you, Amanda. This is a baby, and I'm going to give one of the ladies in the front row a baby. Hey? In the proper sense, of course. That remark was followed by a pregnant pause. Now, you'll do fine. Have you got any children?
No.
Well, you have now. What's your name?
Jerry.
Pardon?
Jerry.
Jerry. It's a fellow with a frock on. No. Now, Jerry. There we are, Jerry. You have that. Now, don't unwrap it. You're right, you haven't got any kids, you can't hold that one, can you? Yeah. You know which way to hold it. Now, Jerry, if you were to have a baby, and I hope one day you do, would you prefer a boy or a girl?
Boy.
A boy. Well, now, the people at home, you see, might think, if you sit there and say, a boy, that when our prediction turns out to be right at the end, because we've made a little prediction, it's a secret, you will find out people at home sit there saying, oh, yeah, 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 he told her beforehand, all right? So what we thought would be a better idea is if we tossed a coin for it. You don't mind, do you?
No.
Funny way to pick a baby, isn't it? Now,
heads. Easier than the other way.
What?
Easier than the other way.
Is it? You find difficult. I can't ask that. Now, listen, this is. Now, look, we've got to toss the coin. Heads, it will be a little girl. Tails, it will be a little boy. Because little boys have little tails, you see? Why, you should always buy little boy jelly babies. You get that much more jelly. Now, this is important. We're going to toss the coin, all right? There we go. Heads, it's a girl. Tails, it's a boy. What have we got?
Heads.
Heads. Therefore, it's a girl. Right? And that is a girl. Would you just check that?
Yeah.
Right? Well, that's a girl. Do you know who the father of this child is? No, you don't. What a confused woman you are, Jerry. Well, we have several prospective fathers for you, all right? Stood up fathers, all right? Would you all stand up, please? Thank you. Now, these are all the prospective fathers. Could we have a look at the Christian names of these fathers? We've got Claude and Phil and Isaac. Isaac? You don't look like an Isaac. Looks like Michael Benteen on a good night. Now, we've got Willie and James and Ben and Fred and Ivor. Now, Jerry, do you fancy any of them?
Not a lot.
Not a lot. Well, you won't know because you haven't had a baby. When they go to a hospital and you have a baby, they always put a little tag around the child with the father's surname on. But we didn't want you to be influenced by the father's surname. You're obviously not influenced by the father's. So what we did was, on these tags, which are a bit bigger than you put on a baby, but it makes it easier for them to see at home, we put the father's names, the Christian names, all right? And we'll find out what the surname is in a minute, because it's on the back of there. But before we do that, we're going to mix these up, some face down, and I want you to get hold of one of those strings and just pull. And you will then pull out one label, all right? And who have you got?
James.
Pardon?
James.
Oh, it's upside down, James. You picked an Australian father. Now, James, there we are. We'll hold that there. That is James. Now, that makes you the daddy. What we'll do is we'll have a look at what you could have called the child, because this really was just to arrive at the surname for the baby. The wee baby. Right. Now then, let's see Claude. What's your surname? Claude Bottom. Now... The well-known lion tamer, you see? I bet you're glad you didn't pick him, aren't you? Yes. The next man along is Phil. Phil McCavity, the well-known dentist. Now, you, sir, Isaac Murphy. Of
obviously a very mixed parentage, sir. Very, yes.
But the Murphy might have appealed to you.
Right, Willie, what's your name? And I should have. Oh, Willie Catcher. A well-known detective. We'll ignore you for a moment, James, because you got picked. Ben. Ben Dover. Yes, there must be something in there that I've missed. Anyway, Ben Dover. Fred Bear. Yes, the well-known tailor and dresser of famous stars. Ivor Notion, the inventor. Those aren't your real names, but thank you for joining in. Will everybody but the real father please sit down? Now, you are the father. Come down here, James. You have those, Amanda. And here comes James. Now, James, the baby is a girl. Therefore, cannot be named after you. See, we want to know, we can't wait now, to find out what the babby's name is. Right, so what's its name? Surname? Riddell. Okay? Jimmy Riddle. Right. So you're Jimmy Riddle. Go ahead, of course, yes. But Jimmy Riddle is the name chosen by the mother. Okay? Well, she can't call the baby Jimmy, can she? Riddle's enough, okay? However, we thought it, as we'd had a 50-50 chance of getting the sex of the baby, right? And as we have now had there were eight names, and you chose Riddell for the surname. How do you fancy the wife then? All right?
Not bad.
Not bad. Not bad. She's a cracker. Right, now then, what we've done is we've got to have you pick the Christian name. And this is a book of names, and we wanted you to pick the Christian name at random. So when the child grew up, couldn't possibly blame you. All right? So what we did was, we found out then when we bought the book, that half the book was boys' names and half the book was girls' names. So not to confuddle the issue, we split it into two. All right? This is the girls' names. We'll use them in a minute. And these are the boys' names. Now, I'll instruct you in the art of choosing a name at random. Can I have the pen, my love? Can you pull the top off? Da. Plop. It's a felt-tip pen. What you do with this is you put the whole lot behind your back like this, so nobody, even you, can be influenced by a decision. You then open the book anywhere and you make a big red cross on any page, right? A big one. And wherever you mark the pen, mark the book, all right, that will be the name of the child at the center of the cross. I'm sure I marked one. There it is. Right, there we are. Now, in this case, you see, it's right in the middle of the description of Godfrey, had it been a boy. So, you have that. Now, you place the book. Girls' names, all girls' names, there's some lovely ones as well, like Thora and Thorberta and Traviata. Yes, I bet the kid would be pleased to be called Traviata. Anyway, you bung that behind your back, right behind your back, and you take the pen, all right, and you come over here so that nobody is influenced at all. He opens the book, he makes a big red cross on one of the pages, a positive cross. And once he's done that, we pick the name that's in the middle of the cross, okay? Have you done that, Flower? You have. You've also got yourself covered in red ink, haven't you? So if you just take this and mop your hands off, and let's have a look at what you have picked. Again, we have a look and see what we have done here. There we are. You have picked, I think you'll agree, that goes through the middle of Hazel. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Yeah?
Hazel. Now you go back to your seat, because I want somebody else to see this, or they'll swear blind it's a fiddle at home. Can you just check that for me? That's Hazel. And for the people at home, of course, there's Hazel, all right? Now, that child is now being named Hazel Riddell. Isn't that lovely? A lovely name for a lovely babby. But you see, we had a bit of a problem. When we decided to do a prediction on the child, I'll take it off you now, love. Thank you. You're really very good at babies, aren't you? Fantastic. Now, when we had this problem, we decided how could we put a prediction somewhere that the audience at home would know I couldn't get at and cheat on the way, all right? To prove it was a genuine prediction, very good, yes, very good. But at least we dressed the baby in pink. I should point out, at this stage, this is not a real baby. All right? Otherwise, we get letters from the NSPCC. There it is, it's a baby. It's dressed in pink because we thought that it might turn out to be a girl, and we were right. What we couldn't have known was the name Riddell, because you chose it from one of eight. What we couldn't have known was the name Hazel, because he chose it from one of thousands of names in the book. But to get to the bottom of the mystery, we decided to print it somewhere we couldn't get at throughout the trick. And if we just pull that down there, I think you'll agree we've arrived at the right house. Well now, there you go, you can look after it again, all right? Now, that's a cheeky kind of magic. And to say that my next act is spectacular and unusual is an understatement. If you have trouble making your garden grow, just watch Dinardi.
Thank you.